opportunity in every situation to learn and grow in wisdom. It's a immense pleasure to welcome you all for this webinar on behalf of Aircrew Aviation Private Limited. Small aim is a crime. It's an honor to welcome our chief guest, Ms. Aman Zaini, IAP, to share his views on the important topic of emergency handling at airport. The session is over to you, ma'am. Once again, we welcome you all.
Thank you, Raja Rajeshwari. Thank you to Captain Shekhar. You have given me an opportunity to interact with all of you. And today's session is on the emergency handling at airports. Just to inform you, I have been associated with Airports Authority of India for last 32 years and have been in airport operations. Could you please, all of you, mute your mics, then it would be better. So here I am giving you a presentation on the emergency handling at airports. So just I'm sharing my screen. Hope you are getting my screen.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this is regarding the emergency handling at airports. As all of you must be aware of, that emergencies can come anytime. We cannot avoid the emergencies. Just next screen, Cassidy. And in case of air travel, we say that air travel is the safest mode of operation, mode of transportation. You can see on the screen, air travel resulted in 0.07 deaths for every 1 billion miles traveled, compared to 212 for motorcycles and 7.28 for cars. So you can see the traveling by motorcycle can be very deadly, while air travel is the safest in terms of accident, as well as nowadays in this corona time, also the air travel is considered to be the safest mode of travel. And this looks, future looks bright for India's aviation system also, and we will continue to make the skies safer and you continue to fly. And for this, like, handling of airport emergencies, which is the topic given to me, I must say that emergencies cannot be avoided. You can just imagine our life, the human life also starts with the emergency. When we are, when a baby is born, that is also a kind of emergency for the mother and the baby. But anyway, a good airport emergency plan can help us to minimize the effects of the emergency, and it can result in saving precious lives and also help in resuming the normal airport operations. So what do we really require for handling airport emergencies? The most important thing is that we need to be calm and cool. We need to make the best use of available resources. Time is the most important factor in case of handling airport emergencies or any kind of emergency. So we have to be very quick and strictly follow the SOPs. And also manage the stress. Because if we are stressful, then we won't be able to handle it properly. So in this today's session, I am going to cover various topics on the emergency handling. In fact, in our Indian Aviation Academy of Airports Authority of India, we are having a 5-day course on this topic, but here I am covering in one session. So I'll be touching on all the topics And you can later on, you can tell me if you want something else also, we can also share. So in this, these are the topics which I'm covering: objective of airport emergency planning, what is airport emergency planning, contents, types, then what agencies involved, emergency operations center, command post, trials and medical care, communications, airport emergency exercises, review, and then summary. So objective, you can just see the objective of any emergency planning, any emergency handling is to minimize the catastrophic effects. In case of air accidents, we get very less time to save lives. So saving lives is the most important thing, and foremost we need to, that's why we have to act very swiftly. And second thing, whenever any accident or any incident happens, second priority is to resume the normal airport operations as soon as possible. So these are the two basic objectives for planning. And with this, if we have a very good emergency plan ready, then we can minimize these effects. So we will talk about the airport emergency plan, and which will help us to spell out the procedures for coordinating the response of different agencies, internal as well as external, that would be of assistance in mitigating the adverse effect of an accident or incident. So then again, the question comes, what is the airport emergency planning? So this is the actually process of preparing any airport to cope up with an emergency occurring at the airport or in its vicinity. And then it sets forth the procedures for coordinating the response of different airport agencies or services and agencies in the surrounding community when the incident happens in the vicinity of the airport. And then you can see structure of airport emergency plan. Each and every airport has individual needs and peculiarities. Some airports are on the coastal area. You can see some airports are in the land area, or some airports are in the rainy land where a lot of rains occurs. So different airports are having different kind of needs and different kinds of emergencies. Then political, jurisdictional, and agency differences also may exist and continue, but the basic needs and concepts of emergency planning evolve around three C's, which are command and control, coordination, and communication. So these three C's are the most important for any making of any emergency plan. So as I earlier also discussed, we make the plan for any emergency at an airport and also in its vicinity. We will define the vicinity also shortly. Now, what is the structure of a good airport emergency plan? The foremost thing is that this plan should be able to give clear instructions to ensure that the actions of each responding agency, like firefighting services or police, security, medical services, or other airlines also, they can take actions promptly. So a comprehensive emergency plan has to consider three things: pre-planning before an emergency, then operations during an emergency, and documentations after an emergency. So these three things are the basic part of the structure of airport emergency plan. Pre-planning before an emergency, you can just think of what can be the pre-planning. So first thing comes in the pre-planning is to just foresee all kind of emergencies which can happen. Planning for handling all foreseeable emergencies that could occur to cripple normal airport operations. We list these kind of all kind of emergencies which can happen at a particular airport, and then identify the resources which are required to tackle this kind of any individual emergency in most effective and productive way. And now this is the pre-planning when we are listing the kind of emergencies which can occur. But during an emergency, operations during an emergency, considerations depend on the stage, nature, and location of the emergency and adapt to changes in an emergency. For example, change in command and control authority, or dramatic change or worsening of situations. For example, in case when the incident happened, there was no rain. Suddenly the rain starts. Then we have to adapt to that change. So that is a dramatic change. Or the person who is the senior most, he becomes the controller. But when his senior comes, then change in command happens. So these are the operations during an emergency. And after an emergency also is very important, because these all kind of, especially at the airport, whatever accident happens, normally there is an DGC inquiry or anything is there. So then support, this documentation becomes very important. Though we can say this is not as urgent as the pre-planning and the operations, but this is also very urgent. This is a requirement. Transition of authority and responsibility after mitigation actions must be planned in advance. And documentations of an emergency operations will help gathering and organizing for various post-accident reports. Airport emergency planning must be implemented similarly for the off-airport aircraft accident and incident. Like I told earlier also, that we plan for the accidents or incidents happening within our airport and within the vicinity. So vicinity means outside the airport boundary wall, but to a certain pre-decided area. Only a change of jurisdiction will be within airport boundary, airport operator overall in charge, but while in the outside airport boundary, pre-arranged mutual aid agency depends on the location of the airport. So policy is on the implementation is on the airport accident, as I earlier also told, airport operator will be in command and mutual aid agencies will assist. While if it is outside the airport, off airport accident, then the agency in command will be the agency agreed upon in the mutual aid to emergency agreement pre-arranged with the surrounding community. So this arrangement, however, should not affect the immediate response by airport personnel or by the agencies having role in airport emergency plan, like firefighting agencies of airport. If it is in the vicinity, then they go there and do the firefighting or whatever is required. In case of aircraft accident off airport, but in the vicinity of the airport, airport fire services is required to play a role in firefighting and rescue operation. And vicinity of airport is defined here, area up to 5 kilometers in the approach path, like in both sides of the runway, up to 5 kilometer approach is considered to be the vicinity of the airport. And if any incident or accident happens in that area, then the airport fire services, they play a role in firefighting and rescue operation. But when it is, because it is outside the airport, the overall command becomes of the other agencies, whoever is there, like city fire, it can be any coast guard also in the coastal areas, or it can be air force or anybody else. In case of off airport accident, aircraft accident, when city fire services are available at the site, the overall command will be exercised by the senior most official of the city fire brigade available at the site. These are the different type of emergencies we have talked about. Now we talk about the contents of AEP. What documents, what things should be there. Types of emergencies planned for, which we have just listed earlier, that first thing, pre-planning, that what kind of emergencies can happen. So type of emergencies. Then agencies involved in the plan. Who all agencies can help us. The most important is C point, that responsibility and role of each agency is very clearly mentioned in this. The emergency operation center and the command post for each type of emergency has to be very clearly mentioned in the plan. Information on names and telephone numbers of offices or people to be contacted in case of a particular emergency, and grid map of the aerodrome and its immediate vicinity. Some of the types of emergencies we have listed here, you can just go through. It can be weather standby because of inclement weather. It can be local standby, some problem pilot has told, then we make arrangements. Full emergency can be, there can be aircraft crash, fire incidents can also happen in aircraft or in terminal building, aircraft accident or incidents, medical emergencies can be there, bomb threats to aircraft or to terminal building, or any unlawful acts against civil aviation, including hijacking or terrorist attack. So umpteen number of type of emergencies can happen, and accordingly we have to list and make an emergency plan for each and every type of emergency. So the first step in viable emergency plan is to have the cooperation and participation of all the concerned airport or community authorities. So agencies to be considered are different agencies are there. Can anybody help me in this? We can make it more including, like if I'm only speaking, if somebody else want to say something about this. Can somebody share? Okay, agencies to be considered here are, can be umpteen number of agencies. I have listed 23. Yes, somebody wants to speak?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, so these are the agencies. Sorry?
You may continue, I think no one is asking anything.
Okay. I would have loved it if it becomes interactive, because it's...
Yeah, sure, sure, of course. Of course.
So different agencies which can be involved in emergency handling and emergency planning are just, I have listed 23 here. It can be even more or less, depending on the location of the airport. So air traffic services, rescue and firefighting services, police, security services, like in our airport, CISF is there, an airport operator like Delhi, Mumbai, private airports, medical services inside the airport or outside medical services also, hospitals in the vicinity, aircraft operators, means airlines, government authorities are there, airport tenants who are working at the airport, rescue coordination centers, civil defense, other military, coast guard, religious bodies, press, media, custom, immigration, postal authorities, veterinary services, DGCA, coroner, voluntary organization. There are a lot of agencies which can be there. We have to list it out that who are the agencies which are in our vicinity and which can be helpful to us. So this can vary from airport to airport. Now, responsibility and role of agencies. If any incident or accident happens on the airport, then normally the agencies involved are ATS, Air Traffic Services, Rescue and Firefighting Services, Police and Security Services, Airport Operator, Authority, Medical Services, Aircraft Operators, Government Authorities, Government Accident Investigation, Health and Welfare, Post Office, Customs, Immigration, Agriculture, Public Works and Environmental Agencies, Public Information Officer. These are some of the agencies which can be involved when it happens on the airport. Most important place is the emergency operation center. Every airport needs to have an airport emergency operation center, which is available to deal with emergency situations. And main features of this unit is its fixed location. It acts in support of the on-scene commander in the mobile command post for aircraft accident or incident. It is the command, coordination, and communication center for unlawful seizure of aircraft and bomb threats, and operationally available 24 hours a day. So all the communication things are available there. They are checked on everyday basis. Location is also very important of this emergency operation center. This should give a clear view of movement area and isolated aircraft parking position wherever possible. I can talk about my Surat airport. Here we have this type of center, but we don't have a clear view of movement area. So for that purpose, we have put some cameras. So through cameras, through high definition cameras, we can see. So that also can be possible. It is generally used in supporting and coordinating operations in accidents and incidents. Necessary equipment and personnel to communicate, which is the most important thing, including the mobile command post. I'll talk about mobile command post later. Here you can see this vehicle. This type of vehicle is available at most of the big airports. It is called mobile command post. This is a self-sufficient office having all kind of communication channels. Everything is, it's a self-sufficient office, which is having two-way communication with the pilot as well as with the emergency operation center and other vital agencies. So here, this is on wheels. So anywhere it can be, whenever any emergency or anything, any incident happens, this vehicle or command post that can be brought over there. On-scene commander can command from this post. This is a point where cooperating agency heads assemble to receive and disseminate information and make decision pertinent to rescue operations. Main features, as I already discussed, is the most important feature is its mobile. Mobile facility capable of being rapidly deployed. And it serves as command, coordination, and communication center. And it is operational during aircraft accident or incident and correctly located with respect to wind and terrain conditions. Wind and terrain condition is also very, very important. We have to see the direction of the wind, and we always place this mobile command post in the opposite side so that with the wind, if a fire is coming, it should not come to the post. In the event of any accident or incident, a designated, recognizable, and readily visible command post is a higher priority item. So you can just see the color. This is having a lights also placed on this. All these type of things are there. It should be established as quickly as possible, preferably at the same time as the initiative of rescue and firefighting activities. It contains necessary equipment to communicate. Communication electronic devices are available in this command post and which are checked very frequently every month. In order to eliminate confusion and missed transmission, headset for each participant is essential and it is available over there. It is also this post, mobile command post is equipped with maps, charts, and other equipment and information. And it's the color is like that. It is easily recognizable during the day, and during the night, there is a rotating light. So you can easily make out the command post. Rescue and firefighting personnel will be the first to arrive at the accident site. And therefore, for a certain period of time, the fire in charge will be in the command. On-scene commander will arrive later and will then assume the all over the command. This transition of authority and command responsibility is, earlier also we had discussed about this, that this needs to be established in the emergency plan and exercised accordingly, that when and till what time, who will be the commander, and after that, who will be the commander, and what will be the responsibilities of each and everybody. If off accident, airport accidents are under the direction and control of the agency agreed upon in the mutual aid emergency agreement, that doesn't come under the airport authority. Here, diagrammatic presentation of commander and coordination plan is made. So you can just see on scene commander, under that chief fire officer, police chief, medical coordinators are there, and other agencies are there. Now we come to the grid map. Grid map is a very, very important document, because with the grid map, we can find out the exact location of the incident. So that this is an integral part of any emergency plan. Here, I can show you this grid map. There are two type of maps we are having, grid map of the airport and also the grid map of its vicinity, the surrounding areas. So preferably two grid maps we provide. This is sample grid map of the airport. You can see the runways here. These are the two runways. And if we see the surrounding community, so this is the airport, and surrounding 10 kilometers surrounding area should also be visible. We should know where the water bodies are there, or where any highway is going, so that it can become easy to go to that area, and the fire vehicles can easily locate that. I can also show you the, this is the grid map of the Mumbai airport. There are two runways which are intersecting. So this is the grid map of the Mumbai airport inside area, and the surrounding area of Mumbai, you can see this is the surrounding. Not very clear, but I just tried to get this map. So it is absolutely essential that when where more than one grid maps are used, the grids do not conflict. Both the grid maps should be similar. I mean, confliction should not be there, that one grid map is showing something else and the other roads and other things, they should be same in both the. Whenever grid map is revised, then also updated copy shall be provided to all the participating agencies, and old map is immediately destroyed. Airports and cities keep on evolving. You know, lot many times some roads are being made, some flyovers are being made. So grid maps of the city as well as of the airport, they keep on evolving. Very important thing is to update, and also to keep the other agencies updated. Information on offices to be contacted. In case of emergency, this is the most important thing. So all the vital telephone numbers, contact numbers, they should be available. Separate flow control charts should be developed for each type of emergency. Method of notification, because inside the airport, like we are having the radio telephony, or we can have the other telephone numbers, hotlines, all these things are, but that has to be clearly outlined. And also most important thing is that these numbers should be verified monthly and revised list issued if any changes have occurred. Nowadays very rapidly people change their numbers, or the person has changed the job, the person is not there, or person has superannuated or transferred, anything can happen. So these type of critical thing is that information, this office information and numbers, contact information should be updated. Now we come to the triage and medical care. Triage, I think you understand the triage. Triage means the sorting of casualties at an emergency according to the nature and severity of their injuries. And triage area is the location where this type of operations are performed. And there are tags used in the classification of casualty according to the nature and severity of their injuries. This you can see in this picture. One person is being carried. So in the aftermath of an aircraft accident, many lives may be lost and many injuries aggravated if immediate medical attention is not provided by trained rescue personnel. Survivors should be triaged. Triage means categorized. So we will see how we categorize. Casualty should be classified into four categories. Priority one, priority two, priority three, and priority four. Priority one is the casualties which require immediate care. Very seriously injured passengers, they come into priority one. Priority two is, okay, they are injured, but slightly delay also is possible. And priority three are small bruises or something, minor injuries are there, then they come in priority three. And priority four is the people who have already dead. So dead bodies, they are come to the zero priority, priority number four. First qualified medically trained persons to arrive at the site must immediately begin initial triage. Whenever an accident happens, the first people to reach at the accident site is the fire people. And second, this is medical team, they reach the site. And these are all listed in the emergency plan very clearly. So when the medical team reaches the site, immediately they start doing the triage. And this person will continue performing triage because they will categorize that this person has to be immediately sent to hospital. This person can just wait, or the other person can sit on the other side. I'll show you the color coding also, how we are doing the color codings. We put the tags on these people. So priority one is given red tag, which is immediate care is required. Priority two, people having some fractured leg or something, but life is not endangered. Then they are yellow tagged and care will be a little delayed. And priority three is green tag, which are having very minor bruises or minor things are there. Then they are minor care. And the deceased people, they are given priority zero and tagged black. This is a sample, triage medical care, priority one, priority two, priority three. But all these people, the most important thing is that whoever, even priority zero, we don't touch immediately. But other people, we make a list, we may keep a record also, because otherwise later on, we will need to know that who all people have been sent to the hospitals or wherever, which ambulance has gone. So we keep a record also here. Control of the flow of injured. Every injured person has to pass through four areas, which should be carefully located and easily identified. The first thing is, first area is collection area. You can just understand if there is a fire in the aircraft, the fire people, they will collect the people from inside the fire site and bring them outside. Location where initial collection of the seriously injured from the debris is accomplished. Custody of casualties is transferred from rescue and firefighting personnel to medical services at this point. But in most of the cases, this transfer takes place at the triage area. Sometimes very seriously, then as directly rescue and firefighting people, they transfer. But most of the time, the doctor or the medical team, they decide in the triage area and they make the triage. This is the, you can see a triage area, location where triage operations are performed. Area should be located at least 90 meters upwind of the accident site. Earlier also I talked about this. We have to see the wind direction. And accordingly, we have to make the triage area, also the mobile command post. All these things have to be upwind of the accident site to avoid possible exposure to fire and smoke. And if necessary, more than one triage area may be established. then care area, location where first aid medical care is given to the injured. Initially, it will be a single care area, but subsequently, this may be subdivided into three sub-areas according to the three categories: immediate care, priority 1, priority 2, priority 3, and color-coded, as I earlier also discussed. Red is for the immediate care, yellow is for the delayed, and green is for the minor care requiring people. We may use colored traffic cones or flags also. Then comes the transportation area, where recording, dispatching, and evacuation of survivors is done. This area should be located between the care area and the exit road. Normally, one transportation area is established, but if there are more than one area, transportation area, then essentially it has to have the communication between them. Otherwise, it would become very difficult to keep a record of people. Ambulatory survivors. Airport operator is responsible to select the more suitable holding area for particular emergency. Normally, there is some area is pre-designed, pre-designated, for this type of requirement. Provide for the transportation of uninjured from the accident site to the designated holding area and arrange for doctors, nurses, or teams qualified in first aid, and furnish a full passenger and crew manifest for accountability purposes. Interview the uninjured or record their names, addresses, phone numbers so that we can reach them, and notify their relatives or next of kin. Here the airlines also plays a very vital role, because people who are available at the airport, this most of these things are done by the concerned airlines or the concerned aircraft operator. Then coordinate efforts with the designated international relief agency like Red Cross or etc. They also come into picture and they also help us. It may be necessary to establish a special holding area which can supply clothing, food, beer, and blankets to prevent hypothermia if required, especially during the winters and all. Then care of fatalities and other activities. This is also one of the very, very important things. We have to preserve the evidence for determining the cause of or future corrective action. Forensic doctors, ensuring the wreckage also is undisturbed till the investigation authority comes over there. We cannot remove any wreckage till the time we get a green signal from the DGCA or the investigation authority. And then supply of disposal, plastic gloves and leather gloves. Normally, they are available for the stretcher bearers. But you know, in such accidents, it becomes very difficult. All gloves should be burned following use in gathering body parts. So all these precautions are taken, photographs, drawing notes, other things, sufficient stock of body bags are also available at the airport. Refrigerated storage facility is desired. Normally we are having this type of facilities at big airports. Post-mortem examination area should be located near the refrigerated storage, with high security arrangements and suitable working area with electricity and running water, large enough for initial body sorting. These type of, at small airports, it's not available, but desirable if, or in this such cases, nearest hospital people, they help us. Now we come to the communications part. Communication is the very, very important for any emergency plan to be successful, because this is the crux. If we can communicate with other agencies, if we can communicate with our people, then only the help can be made available. So it is very essential to have a good communication services, good communication network, equipment, and equally important is testing and verification. So at our airports normally, we are doing verifying this all radio and telephone networks or interagency telephone numbers. They are checked very frequently. Some are checked daily on the daily basis or monthly basis to ensure that they are workable. Now, after this, we have got the plan. We have made it very nicely. But to see that whether this plan will work, we need to do the exercises. And this is mandatory also. We cannot wait for an incident to happen to see that whether the emergency plan works. So we do the exercises very regularly at the airports, testing the emergency plans and then reviewing that and making if any changes are required, that changes are made. You can see in the picture, different agencies have come, they are doing the exercise. Purpose of this exercise, as I have discussed, to test the airport emergency plan. We need to be ensure that the response of all personnel involved is as per the requirement. Emergency plan and procedures, emergency equipments and communication, they are sufficient and they are good. Tests should correct as many deficiencies as possible. So that's why we involve all the agencies, whoever are can help us and possible to come. Personnel and agencies from airport get an opportunity to know each other and their role in the emergency plan. This point is also very important, these exercises play. Whenever we do any airport emergency exercise, because normally in normal circumstances when the airport is running, the agencies from the other agencies outside the airport, they don't normally come to the airport. Doing these exercises may give them an opportunity to come to the airport, to meet, like we can know each other, and they can understand their role better to be played in the emergency plan. So this is a very important aspect of this emergency exercises. Outside agencies get an opportunity to meet airport personnel, familiarization with airport facilities, resources, traffic pattern, identifiable restricted or prohibited hazard areas. Then testing is very crucial for determining where serious gaps exist. Also, very important thing is we have made a very good plan, but individual misconceptions or misunderstandings can be there, which can come up during these exercises. And we can clarify that. And also we can clearly mention in the plans so that there is no misconception or misunderstanding. Procedures seem workable on paper, but may not work in practice. It can happen. So these exercises, as per ICAO, International Civil Aviation Organization, this is a body, UN body, which gives us guidelines regarding every field of aviation. As per ICAO, exercises should be held in daylight, twilight, darkness, and various conditions of weather or visibility. You know why? Because accidents can happen anytime. We are not sure when the accident will happen. So we need to do these exercises also accordingly during the all type of conditions, especially during night time, because there is very, it is different to work in the day and during the night. Types of emergency exercises and schedule. There are normally two types of schedules: full scale exercise, which happens once every 2 years, and partial exercises during the year when full scale exercise is not concluded. Because carrying out these exercises also involve a lot of expenditure. So we don't do it every now and then, but every 2 years, every alternate year, we do the full scale exercise where we call all the agencies. And in the mid-year year, when we are not doing full scale exercise, we do the partial exercise. Besides, we are doing modular tests in the first year, a series of modular tests commencing in the first year and concluding in a full scale aerodrome emergency exercise at the end of third year. So these modular tests are carried out every now and then. Then partial emergency exercise also we are doing This is also economical because scope is limited and can be repeated as often as required. And if this is partial emergency exercise, it's restricted to one unit or one agency or combination of maybe both, or the objective may be to train new personnel, evaluate new equipment or techniques. So this type of partial emergency exercise we keep doing. Full scale emergencies, when we do, that's our first step in planning full scale emergency exercises, to have the support of all airport and community authorities concerned. First and most basic step is to decide exactly what should be achieved. So aim of the exercise, formulation of a scenario, assigning of task, that has to be decided. Whenever we do this type of full scale emergency exercise, we plan at least 120 days prior to the schedule. So you can just understand, 4 months in advance we do the planning. And there are various meetings are conducted before doing such exercise. Aim of the exercise should be outlined, scenario is formulated, work tasks are assigned. Also, we keep some observers. This is the most important in this exercise. Observer critic team should be organized, comprised of members who are familiar with mass casualty accident proceedings. So these observers are very, very important for us, because these are the people who give us feedback. A team chairman should be appointed. Each member of the critic team should observe the entire exercise and complete the appropriate emergency drill critic form. So as soon as convenient after the exercise, critic meeting should be held so that members of the team can present their observations and recommendations for improvement of the airport emergency plan and procedures. We call it debriefing meeting. And this is the most important meeting, because in this only we come to know that what are the deficiencies, where we can improve upon. Evaluation system, like exercise planning, exercise implementation, exercise evaluation. So this is a process. We evaluate, then again exercise planning, implementation, and then again evaluate. Also, this was the exercise, but if any accident happens, after that also review is done. Oral or written report from all participating personnel, and complete a document covering the entire response operation. Tabletop meeting is held, and we see that what are the changes are required to be made so that response capability can be increased for the future emergencies. So I'm summarizing now what we did we learn today. So most of these points are, some first thing is, we must understand that emergencies cannot be avoided. They have to occur. Howsoever precautious we are, howsoever good airports we are having, but emergencies 100% cannot be avoided. But what we can do is that good airport emergency plan, that we can have, and that can help us to minimize the catastrophic effects and also result in saving the precious lives. And also to resume the normal airport operations as early as possible. This is possible with a good airport emergency plan. And second important thing here we have learned is that emergencies cannot be handled alone. Any airport operator cannot handle everything alone. It requires to have the cooperation and participation of all the concerned airport or community authorities. Within the airport, the airlines people are there, police people, security, and so many other medical agencies are there, and community, the surroundings, hospitals, if defense areas are there, then defense people are there, coast guards or other people kind of. Third important thing in the good emergency plan is the good communication system, including the contact information, updated contact information, which is tested and verified, including backup options. This is the heart of this plan, the good communication system. three C's of emergency planning we cannot forget: the command and control, coordination and communication. Then fifth important thing we have learned here, that regular airport emergency exercises and review is an integral part of AEP that help in making relevant changes to the airport emergency plan to increase the response capability for future emergencies. So these are the references I have taken from ICAO standard and recommended practices. Annex 14, Volume 1, Chapter 9 talks about the aerodrome emergency planning, and Airport Service Manual Part 7, Doc 9137 is the ICAO document on this subject. You can refer these two documents for further more details on this. And thank you so much. Any questions, please?
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am, is there any difference between airport authority and private airport operator?
Sorry?
Difference between airport authority and private airport operator?
Yes. The Airport Authority of India is looking after the airports as well as. Because traditionally, you know, there was only the Airport Authority of India was the owner of all the airports. Now, the privatization of service airports. Please mute your mic. Yeah. I'm explaining, the Airports Authority of India is the owner of most of the airports. But recently, for the last 10 years, like privatization is happening. Delhi and Mumbai airport have been given to private operators. So there the airport operator is the private operator. While the ATC and CNS is still with the Airports Authority. That's why when I'm talking about Airports Authority, some of the airports, Airport Authority is also the airport operator, but at some private airports, like Airport Authority may not be the airport operator. I think I'm clear?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, one more question.
Yes.
Ma'am, what is Indian Aviation Academy and who all can join in IAA, ma'am?
Okay, Indian Aviation Academy is an institute in New Delhi, which is a joint venture of Airports Authority of India, Bureau of Civil Aviation Security, and Director General of Civil Aviation. And most of the here, all the courses, whichever is given there, you can also visit their website, which is www.iaa.edu.in. And most of the courses here are sponsored through your organizations. We are not giving any courses for the general public.
Any opportunities for fresh MBAs opening?
Yeah, there is one. Rajiv Gandhi Aviation University has come up. I think they are starting that.
Thank you.
Okay, anything? Any question regarding this? Because this is actually, in Aviation Academy, we are having a 5-day course on this. And
thank you, ma'am. I think you have explained everything very beautifully and very proper description. So I'll ask Rajeshwari to conclude the session. Rajeshwari?
Yes, sir. We would like to propose a hearty vote of thanks to you, Ms. Aman Zaini, IAP, for gracing today's webinar and delivering the important topic on emergency handling at airport. I am sure that all the participants have taken note of your suggestion and will intake and future in their career. Lastly, we thank you again on behalf of the whole ARCO Aviation Private Limited team. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, Rajeshwari.
Thank you.